Before we take questions from the audience, do any of the panelists have additional comment?
I just have one to follow on to Dick's remarks. I think that the Justice Department has heard the message from this broad coalition, and those of us who have been speaking to this for a number of years have been afforded an opportunity to be heard, I think, on this issue. Paul McNulty is the current Deputy Attorney General. I don't know whether there'll be a McNulty memo to follow the Thompson Holder memo per se, but I think that there will be some change in policy in this regard in the near future. How far it will go, I think, is in play. I'm not sure, frankly, that I agree with the thrust of Senator Spector's bill that the Department of Justice should never be able to affirmatively ask for a privilege waiver. I can think of circumstances, if I put my prosecutor hat back on, where it might be appropriate for it to be able to ask. And certainly through the assertion of the crime fraud exception to the privilege rule doctrines, the department can assert the legal right to invade the privilege. And then that brings judges into the mix, which I think is a healthy thing. But I agree with what Dick said, and I applaud the Justice Department for affirmatively taking a hard look at addressing those issues.
I'll just say one thing also. It will be to underscore the last remarks. With regard to waiver, it's true to say today that most employees don't appreciate what corporate counsel calls the Upjohn warning, which is when they're interviewed, corporate counsel will tell them that the information is protected by attorney-client privilege, but remember that the corporation is the client and not you. It's their way of saying you don't have the privilege. Employees don't really understand that. They think they're giving confidential information. That's true now. But my take on a lot of the Department of Justice policy is that it usually ends up being counterproductive. And since moving to Georgetown, I've been teaching MBA students. Employee failure to understand what's going on will end soon, because the MBA students of today have absorbed the following lesson, which is as soon as any kind of investigation takes place, get your own personal counsel and say nothing. And what that means is the information is getting out there to not provide the kind of information that businesses need to really correct problems ahead of time. And it's because things are finally filtering down.
One of the difficulties with this area is that regardless of what might be forthcoming from the Department of Justice by way of amending their approach, the genie's out of the bottle. And as the professor indicates, there is now developing an awareness of the fact that this waiver can either be coerced or voluntarily made, and really robs the attorney-client privilege of the value that the court has long since, and the common law actually, put on it. And so I think that it's going to take an extraordinary effort to kind of re-educate lawyers and corporate executives and employees as to what the real meaning of the attorney-client privilege is. You can't put the genie back in the bottle. Nowadays, in fact, I can envision a prosecutor approaching corporate counsel and saying, well, the Department of Justice has amended its rules. We can no longer take into account any waiver of the attorney-client or work product privilege, but wink, wink, nod, nod. If you're forthcoming with that on a voluntary basis, then it will be taken into account. So a lot of this really is damage control, but it's still, I think, very much worth the effort. I wanted to add one thought to George Terwilliger's very apt observations about the status of the federal criminal law. Few people realize that we have no federal criminal code. In fact, a huge number of criminal offenses exist outside of Title 18 of the U.S. Code, which is supposed to be the criminal code. And by the accretion process that George has described over the years, there has developed this hodgepodge of offenses, which serves nobody's purpose whatsoever. Every once in a while, there is a surge of interest in creating a true federal code based on the model penal code effort that found its way into the law of many states in the earlier part of the last century. I was involved in one of those efforts during the 1970s as a result of the work of the so-called Brown Commission, headed by former California Governor Edward Brown. And it really set forth a marvelous reorganization in rational terms of a set of legal rules that were totally disorganized and irrational. Unfortunately, it came up during the aftermath of the Watergate era, when people were very suspicious about any change in any kind of law, and it foundered. And it has since found no champions in the Congress to cast it forward. Those of us who have this kind of messianic zeal about criminal code reform occasionally tug at the sleeve of leaders of the bar and leaders in the Congress to try to get it back on the agenda, but it hasn't made its way there, and it proliferates, and the most pernicious form is what George indicated, and that is the routine criminalization of regulatory violations. The last part of every statute passed with regard to regulating some form or another of activity criminalizes anything that contradicts what's gone beforehand. This is foolishness. It creates confusion. There's widespread duplication and an opportunity for those of us who are clever defense lawyers to sometimes frustrate the efforts of those who have passed and are enforcing our laws. So I sneak in a commercial, if I might, for a rejuvenation someday before it may be too late, of interest in having a true federal criminal code that would greatly simplify the task for all involved in seeing that sensible, reasonable laws are enforced in a sensible, reasonable way. Thank you.